Welcome, friends, to this holiday party of the year. Every December we meet, shortly after 26th of November. The reason for doing it in December is, first of all, it's a holiday season. It's a Christian holiday, Jewish holiday, Hindu holiday. It's a holiday in many traditions. Today is the day when a very well-known person spoke to his friend, his boss. He spoke for 3 hours. And those 3 hours have been recorded. And that's the second largest book read in the world. It's the next after the Bible. And it's called the Bhagavad Gita. Today was the day that Krishna spoke to Arjun on the chariot as his driver of the chariot, the chauffeur of the chariot. And it was during a battle going on. The battle of two cousin families was taking place and the armies were poised against each other. And before the battle began, Krishna pulled the chariot which belonged to Prince Arjun and began to give him a discourse. And he discoursed on so many subjects and so many spiritual subjects that it baffled Arjun. He couldn't understand why Krishna has decided to give this great discourse in the middle of the battle. And why is he giving a discourse which was so important to a single person sitting on a chariot? And he asked these questions. Why are you giving me this discourse which is so important, touches upon every aspect of human life, and you are telling me in the midst of a battle when we are about to fight and kill each other? Krishna says, you have killed each other already. It's not you're going to kill today. You have been killed at a future date, and I can show you that this is not something new that's happening. It's already happened. We're just going through the motions of watching it. Everything is already predetermined, including the death of your people in battle. So he said, very difficult to believe that things which we are deciding now, you're deciding to talk to me now, and I'm listening to you now, could be predetermined to such an extent. He said, everything is predetermined. And we go through life with predetermined roles to play, which we think we are creating now. No, we are repeating those because we are very good actors. We are such good actors that we have learned our roles by heart, gotten when we learned them. We become the very characters that we were supposed to play a role in. And that's what we are playing here. He also said, Arjun, you say that you are talking to one person. I'm not talking to one person. Whatever I am saying to you will be recorded. And it will be read by millions of people. It is not necessary to speak to millions of people in order to be read by millions. You can say to one person who is influential enough to convey the message to everybody, Arjun, you are the prince who will convey this, and therefore the whole world will know. Very important messages. But the most important message he gave on that day, which is an anniversary of the day today, was on yoga. Yoga is union. Union with your true self in your true reality. That was the subject, very important subject in that Gita that he spoke. He said you can achieve union and become a true yogi by one of three methods. And he defined those three methods. He said the first I could call karma yoga, a yoga of action. When we act in this physical world and our mind wants a result of that action, it does not make you a yogi. If you can act and you can act to your best capacity and best skill and not expect anything in reward, you are a yogi. He said, yogi does not mean to give up everything and say, I'm waiting for something to happen. It means act. Do your part, whatever is required at that moment. Do it as skillfully as you can. Yoga karmasu kaushalam. Yoga must be done with the utmost skill. That means any action you perform. If you are skilled in teaching, teach the best. If you are skilled as an engineer, do your best. If you are skilled in any other type of work, do it as best as you can with the utmost skill and don't expect any reward, you are a yogi. He says expecting a reward brings the mind into play and therefore you cannot be yogi if you are still working with the mind. He said there is a second way of doing it. He called it Sankhya Yoga or Jnana Yoga, the yoga of knowledge. He said you can acquire more knowledge, read more books, listen to more discourses, go to various places and learn more from there. Keep on learning. Keep on discussing in your mind what you have learned. And after intense learning, you will find learning leads you nowhere. And you can become a yogi. It's a great method to find. And the reason he says is the same. The reason is you only learn with your mind. When you learn with your mind and mind can learn no more, it gives up. And you can transcend and know the soul and not the mind and become a yogi. But he says the best way, better than these two, is third way called Bhakti Yoga, the yoga of devotion. He says that's the highest because when you are experiencing love and devotion, the mind cannot come into it. Love and devotion is the one experience which the mind cannot get into. Therefore, if you can lead your life with love and devotion, with someone who is giving nothing but love and devotion, you get become a yogi. A very important messages in that book he spoke on this day. On Bhakti Yoga, he expounds. He says, Bhakti Yoga alone really can take you beyond the mind to sight. They're all there. He gives a lifestyle how to live in Bhakti Yoga. Love and devotion is not a one-time love with one person. It's love with somebody who contains the whole. It's love with somebody in the world. Krishna said he came into the world as a human being, like anybody else. He said he was a young child. And as a child, he could tell some things to his friends. He mentioned one instance. His young childhood friend was Udo. And he would go out with Udo to take care of the cows of the village. And the cows would graze all day. And Udo and Krishna would roam around watching the cows graze and talk to each other. One day, Krishna says, Udo, karma cannot be understood easily. We believe in karma. It's our action lead to reaction. But we don't understand it fully. We think that action and reaction cancel each other. Therefore, we can do a good deed to cancel a bad one we have done. He said, Udo, that is not true. There is no cancellation in the law of karma. And I, during my journeys in India, wanted to go how people are treating Krishna in their home village, in the hometown where they played around. So I went to the very place where Krishna played some games and some jokes with Udo. And when I went there, I saw a lot of people, farmers, who worked during the day. At night, they would sit together and sing songs. And I sat with them to see what songs are they singing. And one of the songs, the main song they were singing, was, the refrain of the song was, Are Udo Karman ki gat nyari se. Popular song. Every evening they would sing and be so happy. All day's work. They were very poor people. They were not enjoying riches or something. They were enjoying a song. And the song said, Udo Karman ki gat nyari se. Which means, the law of karma is very strange. And he gives an explanation then later on by pointing to Udo. He says, Udo, look, watch, an ant is crawling in front of us. He said, can you believe this ant has once been Brahma, the creator of this universe? At one time, this very ant has been Indra, one of the lords of a big heaven in the astral plane. Because of its karma, it became Brahma. The same soul that because of its actions, and karma became Brahma, the creator of these three worlds. Also because of his karma, became an ant. that if Brahma can become an ant, you can imagine what the law of karma is like. People try to atone for their actions. Atonement does not work. A person who does a heinous crime, bad action, which entitles him to spend 15 days in hell, does a great, wonderful help to other people and a beautiful, wonderful karma, and has 15 days in heaven, he goes to hell and heaven. That's the law of karma. It's not that simple. There is no atonement. This is such a grip upon the soul in this creation. It can do no good deeds and get out of it. You can be rewarded for it. The law of karma holds us down forever. How did we get into this trap of karma that is so terrible that you can't get out of it? Anytime you try to do good things, you get rewarded. Bad things, you get punished. Stay where you are. It's like prisoners. I was once training for a jail warden, for being a jail superintendent, and I spent a year training for jail service. I would see in those prisons, the people who are not behaving properly in the prison are being whipped on their backs till it was bleeding on their backs. Terrible punishment. Those who are doing very good work, well-behaved prisoners, were being put in A class. But all of them were in the prison. Nobody left the prison because they behaved better. They had to serve their term. We are serving our term. We are serving an indefinite term. Why has it become indefinite? Because we came here by the power of the law of karma. If there was no karma, we would not be here at all. Nobody is here. Neither the enlightened yogis, nor the perfect living masters. Nobody has ever taken a human form without the law of karma. Karma creates human life. In fact, karma, entire destiny of a whole life, is made up first before we are born, before we are even conceived. Even the entire destiny from birth to death, everything that will happen is first put together as a package before an egg receives a sperm and becomes a cell. Then only it develops in the mother's womb as a human being, directed by the karma it carries, the counterpart of which could be the DNA is carried. It's just a physical representation of karma. The karma directs how the body will be formed. It's not the human being who is there. It's part of the mother. It's part of the mother sitting in a form of flesh. Flesh and blood and cells and DNA, molecules and everything in it. All ready to become a human being. But the human being who is going to come into that body, they'll be walking out alive, even at that time. He's not dead. His body is being prepared. It's only in the fifth month of pregnancy, when the quickening takes place and the mother feels there is something moving inside, that the soul and astral body and mind of the person who has died comes and begins to live a life inside the mother. At birth, it comes out outside as a newborn person. Karma is carried right from the beginning and still there. Grows up outside the world according to the karma, lives a whole life according to karma, dies according to karma, which is prepared in advance. How it is prepared? With the law of karma. What is the law of karma? It says, every moment you spend here in human life is a result of what you did in past lives, in past human lives. Supposing you had no past human life. Supposing you are coming straight from your true home where there is no mind, no body, no senses, no karma. Supposing it's your very first entry in time into a human body. How can you do it? They prepare a notional set of destinies of a human being, which becomes your past life in order to create one present life. You never lived that. When you are born, it becomes your past life. You never lived it, but it's your memory. There are, in the causal plane, in the plane of the mind, there are some records kept. Millions of them, billions of them. I can't count them how many they are because there's so many. None of you would be able to count them. They're almost infinite. They're all possible permutations and combinations of a human body and human life. When you come and want to have the experience of a physical world and a physical experience, you pick one of those combinations. And they are called the Akashic Records. They come from the Akash, from the sky. They're stored in the sky. The blue, orange, gold sky. The golden sky houses those records. And they're all destinies. Each destiny there has a present life and the past lives to create it. Each of those destinies has infinite past lives. It cannot have a few. Because the question will come up, where did that one come from? If you have a notional past life you never lived, which leads to your present life, then the notional past life also has to another past life. So when you pick one past life, it's got a string of infinite past lives to create that one past life. One per present life. String of past lives. And a string of future lives based upon the karma of that one present life. All predetermined. Then what is your role and why should you come and suffer some of the consequences of coming into this physical world? Why should you enter a world of pain and pleasure, a world of ups and downs, a world of reward and tragedies? Why would you do that? You didn't do anything to get it. It was done in a computer, in a little chip, in a DVD, in something pre-recorded. But you are responsible for everything because you picked it up. From the Akashic Records, you picked it up. Your willful, spiritual will was exercised to pick up one life. And one life led to all the other lives. I don't know whether we should call it a blunder that we made. Or maybe we did a good thing in the eyes of a spiritually enlightened person, we did a good thing. In the eyes of those who have no spiritual vision, it was a very bad thing to do. Blunder. Because we deliberately got trapped into something from which there is no escape. The law of karma gave no escape to us. And therefore, we got into big trouble by getting into one life, one present life. How is it good from the spiritual point of view? It is good because we had decided before we ever came to experiment with these three worlds, before we ever came to have the great knowledge of an extended use of consciousness, before we did that, we made an arrangement within the system to get out of it when we want. What was that system? System was to look at the possible million trillions of those different designed destinies, pick up that into which one of the past lives, giving us a reasonable time to live through these lives, in one of the future lives, there's a possibility to meet a human being like ourselves who is at that time connected with our true home and can take us back home. It was not another human being. It was the one self. In our true home, there don't happen to be two. There's only one. That one designed it. One designed it that when we go into an experience of the many and we get trapped into a certain law of karma through which we are creating this whole experience, that we should be able to go back, that one decided to be another human being in a future life when we have had enough of that experience to be able to come back because that other human being will be our one itself. In manifest form, will be able to tell us when to go back. That is good news for spiritual seekers. That's why they are seekers. Spiritual seeker does not become a seeker by itself. He predestines himself to be a seeker. And when he seeks, that guy turns up, who is the same as the one. Both the seeker and the human being whom we call a perfect living master are the same in our true home. It's only a manifestation of our way to get out of this very terrible trap. If we don't have the arrangement, we reborn, we are continuously coming back, going and coming back into this world in several species, 8.4 million species, depending upon what we think is our karma, picked up only once in the Akashic records, and picked up with due diligence. If we didn't have due diligence, we are stuck. How long are we stuck if we don't have that arrangement? Are we stuck forever? Or are we stuck for some time if we are not seekers? And we don't know anything about this subject. We have never opened ourselves to this. We think this world is the only thing. You are born for one life, you will die. If that's our situation, this kind of belief will not prevent the law of karma to operate. It will still happen. But when will all these souls that are coming again and again without making the arrangement to go back home, what will happen to them? The one who creates everything, the ultimate creator, has provision for them too. Although, when they come here, they're infinite lives, and therefore they can stay infinitely in these three worlds. He has made an arrangement that after some time, maybe long periods, he'll dissolve the whole show. Everybody will go back. Maybe several million years, maybe trillion years, maybe many yugas. One day, a paralaya will take place, a dissolution, in which there will be no soul left here, no body left, nothing will be left, all move up. They move up to a state of being from where they can come again in a new creation. This provision for end of a creation itself is the only time the others will also go back. How far they go back depends on the type of dissolution. There are several dissolutions that take place and take us out of this physical world, take us out of our sensory systems, take us even out of our mind. But they still retain us in a semi-sleepy state. The soul still sleeps, waiting for a new karma to come, sits in Parabrahma. And when the Brahma and the other creation takes place, back to square one, and we start our life again. But those who have made the arrangement to go back, they go back so happily. They have found the way. They are not happy because they are run out of the misery of this world. They are happy that we know now the way, how to come and go. They can come again. They can come again. Then they are again feeling very bad, where have we got lost ourselves. But they know that they made the arrangement to go back when they are tired, when they are fed up with the observance of the events of these three worlds, the three worlds of illusion, the three worlds of Maya, the three worlds which are mithya, which are not going to be permanent, three worlds of physical, astral, causal, three worlds of a physical material body, the world of sense perception alone, and the world of a thinking mind. These are the three worlds. All these three worlds are illusion. Why do we call them illusion? But they look so real. How can you call a thing illusion when it's so real, looking so real? The scientists say in physics today, and for some time, that what we are seeing as solid stuff around, including people, is nothing but space. And space has nothing in it. How are we in it, the space, and it's still space? After we are in it, we are still space. There's no physical stuff in it. They say, supposing space is pulled out from this world, from this planet, from this universe, from the galaxies, space is pulled out, nothing will be left. Not that we are pulled out, we can be here. If only space is pulled out. When I was studying physics in 1943, in the college, a physics professor told us, this planet looks so big, actually it is space. If you pull the space out, it will contract to the size of a football. is so small. And the rest is all filled up with space. The real material stuff is only a football. That was 1943. In 1963, 20 years later, at Harvard University, a physics professor tells us, if all the space is pulled out, it will become like one marble. In 1983, the physics professor says, if the space is pulled out, it will be a pinhead. In 2003, they said there won't even be a pinhead. So we are all space, nothing else. Once a well-known master, guru, Satguru, a Satguru who was a guru of one of my colleagues when I was working for government. My colleague loved me, loved my praising my own guru. He praised his own guru. Then one day he comes to me. We were both in high positions. We were chief secretaries of states. I was chief secretary of one state. He was chief secretary of the neighboring state. But we had different gurus. He came to me and he said, my guru wants to meet you. I said, most welcome. How about your guru? I say, he's dead. He died in 1948. I'm sorry he can't meet you. But I'll be very happy to meet your guru who's alive. So he brought his guru to me. Beautiful man. And the man comes and says, my disciple praises you so much. He said he goes to you and recharges his spiritual battery. I thought I might also go and see you. He said, most welcome, sir. What can I do for you? He says, I've come to initiate you. I said, I'm already initiated by a perfect living master. He said, but that's no good initiation. That makes you do meditation. That makes you do restrictions on diet. That makes you do listening to sound by plugging your ears and wasting all that time. My method is very simple. I show you Guru. I show you God. I show you and when I initiate you. I can show you the whole creator of this entire universe at the very time when I initiate you. I said, I am not in a hurry. I'm willing to wait. He said, no, I'll show you right now. I said, all right, go ahead, initiate. So he initiated me and showed me the creator of the whole universe. You ought to see that? One of you ought to see the creator right now. I share the same initiation. If you want to see, he said, hold your hands like this, which I did. Bring them together. Separate them again. What do you see in the middle of your hands now? All we could see was space. Space in the creator. I was in my heart laughing at that time that this is an initiation to show me God. At night I realized he was telling the truth. He was telling the real truth. Not only verified within our own meditation, verified by physics outside. He showed me the creator of this whole planet. It was all within my hands. It's all over. You can point out anywhere that's the creator. If space is taken out, nothing is left. Because of this, physics is a big quandary today. How can space create matter? There must be some energies built into it, some kind of frequencies of energy going on that are creating us. But who is operating it? There's nothing here except space. You, like a balloon, you're expanding in space and creating universes and galaxies and people and philosophers and seekers. What is this? So, the new speculation is maybe this is a big game being played by somebody outside this universe on a digital scale with a small computer. They're creating a hologram from a computer and using his consciousness to spread out amongst the created puppets who are all acting with the consciousness of the creator, and they are not going outside the program of his own. And there, physically speaking, what I'm now saying is not philosophy. They stepped into physics. Physics is saying there may be some guy, intelligent guy, who's got a nice computer and can produce a hologram and a big one, and in which he can place little objects created out of one simple little twist, a literal twist called gravity. A little twist that he can program, whole thing will come up. It's physics. Saying that there is some intelligence, could be some intelligence. What does meditation do? Deep meditation. Deep meditation does not go out to examine a galaxy or examine our planet. Deep meditation goes inside to see what is the role of our consciousness inside or life force inside in having these experiences. And by going within, we get the experience that what we are calling our real world, calling our real material physical world, is merely something, we don't know what, something our perceptions are showing to us. We open our eyes and we see something and we define it with what we are seeing. We open our ears, we begin to hear. We use five senses. And people realize nobody has any access to any reality except through the sense perceptions. Unfortunate. That all we are seeing around is with our sense perceptions. Cut the sense perceptions out, the world disappears. What the world is like, we have no idea. We only see what our perception can hold. Then it becomes even more difficult if you go further in meditation. You find in meditation that what you are going to perceive with your eyes open are being prepared inside. What you are going to see outside, people, objects, places, time, space, what you are going to see outside is actually being prepared inside. And then you can look at the preparer yourself. Nobody else. That we, our own self, are preparing something which we will then observe through perception. Then is the world inside us or outside? Very difficult to explain that if we are preparing our entire world, which we can see through perception, is being prepared inside, and we can see the preparation personally, that the self is preparing that, and we open our eyes and open our ears and see a world, is it inside or outside? Something is creating it outside. Maybe space. Maybe space is the thing that pulls it and pulls our prepared destiny outside and projects it like it's a real life, real world. Or maybe it's a real world that makes us believe as human beings that we are able to meditate and go and see something inside. Which one is true? It's not very clear. Not very clear to us. And not very clear to thousands of people for thousands of years. But they have been debating it. Those who say, no, it's not possible for a human being born within the material world to say he's creating the world. That's not possible at all. Those people are called the materialists. The others are saying the process of knowing you are creating anything, including yourself, is part of what the ideas inside us are creating. They're called idealists. The debate between the materialists and the idealists has been going on for thousands of years. The unfortunate part is that they don't want to examine the data from which you start, the assumptions from which we start. Therefore, we stick to our own assumptions, and therefore we can't find any truth. To be a real seeker of the truth, you should make no assumption except what you can experience personally, immediately. If there is no immediacy in your experience, your one day of experience has no value. If you can experience something right now, that you can say is some good point to start with. There are at least two experiences of human beings that are imminent, immediate, and prove themselves. No matter whether it's philosophy or science, no matter whether it's mysticism or it's physics, no matter what it is, two things all human beings know for absolute 100% certainty. And what are those two? One, that we exist, that we are there. Everybody knows. Nobody has ever denied it. Neither the atheist, nor the materialist, nor the philosopher, nor the idealist. Nobody has ever denied this fact, that we exist. Why don't they deny? Because that's the experience we're all having. It's not something to look forward to. It's not something to accept from somebody else's mouth. It's not somebody to go into a religion or to go into spirituality to find out. We are there by our own experience. Good point to start, that we are there. What's the second experience? Second experience has been generated into the current experience. And that is the body through which we are experiencing something can go to sleep and have a dream. We all have dreams. Some point or other. Some remember a few, some remember more, but we all have dreams. And therefore, we have the capacity to have a dream in sleep. What is the certainty? When we wake up from sleep, we are certain that we have woken up. I have not found anybody in the world saying, I'm not sure if I've woken up from a dream state. These are two very simple truths we all experience without faith, without any kind of religion, spirituality or anything. We know we exist, we know when we go to sleep, we wake up. If you wake up and somebody comes and say, you are not awake. 1,000 people can come and say, no, you're not awake. You know you are awake. How do you know you're awake? Because you had another experience, which was not wakefulness, looked wake till you woke up again. When we are in the dream state, we think it's real. We don't think that we're dreaming. Sometimes we do, which is very interesting. It's interesting because when we are in a dream state and we say, maybe it is a dream, what do? We ask some other people whom we are watching. Do you think it could be a dream? Then there's a discussion. It's all in the dream happening. Then we discuss with other people. How do we know it's a dream? Other person says, no, it's not a dream. It's just the idea that it's a dream. It's not a dream. It doesn't look like a dream at all. There's a debate going on. And then you say, but I know it's a dream. No matter whether these people know or not. And suddenly we wake up. Those people are not there at all. We were trying to check level of awareness, a level of wakefulness with a reference to the very part that's part of the dream state. Only when we woke up to a higher level of wakefulness, not dream wakefulness, we discovered that we are awake. There has never been any human being in this whole universe who did not know after getting up from sleep that he had woken up. Therefore, to wake up from a different level of experience is a certainty. Let's take these two together. If this life we are leading is also a dream, we don't know. If we check with each other, we'd all say, not a dream, it's real. And supposing we wake up to a consciousness that's more awake than this one, this will all become a dream at once. With no doubt about it. With certainty. For the same reason we are certain when we wake up from the physical dream that we physically go into sleep. That is why if these things are known to us, that if we wake up, we will be certain that we are awake. Not depend on anybody else's evidence. It will be our own evidence of 100% certainty, not a blind faith, not faith at all, an experience of wakefulness. Question is, can we really wake up from already awakened state? Can we wake up to higher level of wakefulness? We can experiment. We can't be certain, but we can experiment. If we do wake up, we'll be certain we have woken up. Therefore, what system should we try to see if we can wake up more than we are awake now? Let's take an example of a man, our friend, sleeping in our house. He's dreaming. His dream is he's taking his horses back to the stable. I'm just taking an example. A man is dreaming and he's in our house. We are not dreaming, we are awake. The man is sleeping, he's talking, he's murmuring, horse. We know he's dreaming of a horse. He's taking his horses in the dream. We want him to wake up for breakfast. So we say, get up, get up. He's still thinking of horses. He is thinking of the horses are speaking. Dream undergoes a change. We became a poke. Get up. And he feels something. He says, but who will take my horses home? He speaks up. He's still half dreaming. Who will take my horses home? And we said, don't worry, I'll take your horses home. Get up. And he wakes up. He never asked where the horses are. He does not know where will you take my horses. The nudge that was given was merely to wake him up and to enter into his dream. So that when he is awake, he's not bothered about the horses of the dream. He's awake. And he will know he's awake. So will we know. He's in our house, he's awake. We just gave him a nudge to wake up. Is it possible to get a nudge in this level and wake up more? If that can happen to a person sleeping in our house and we give him a nudge and he wakes up by combining part of his experience with the voice of the person who's trying to wake up, is it possible the same thing can happen here? Possibly, yes. Who can give us a nudge like that? Only somebody who's awake compared to us. If somebody who is awake gives us a nudge and we wake up and we'll say, where did you come from? Where did you come? Who are you? We won't ask any question. Because we'll find he just gave a nudge. The nudge became an experience. What is that experience which we have here, which is equivalent to a nudge to a sleeping person? The experience is called initiation by a perfect living master. That's the nudge. In the case of the horses, he might get up after 5 seconds, 10 seconds. Here we take a few years, few months, sometimes a lifetime, sometimes more than one lifetime. But the nudge is the same. It's a nudge from somebody who's awake more. We can't see. We can't see who's giving us the nudge. But we combine that nudge with an experience we are having here, which is an experience with a human being, whom we call a perfect living master. How do we know that he has been there in our dream because of our nudge, his nudge in the wakeful state? We know it because he's pulling us with the power of love, which nobody else has done that. That the power of love of a human being, ordinary human being, is pulling in a strange way, which is not normal, and is trying to awaken us. Something is happening. We halfway. Knowing who that person is, halfway ignorant of it. This is a great system. It's built into the whole creation. And that is why the perfect living master we define is not somebody who is a person who knows God or person who knows this, person who is enlightened in many ways. A perfect living master in the life of a seeker is the one who is going to give him a nudge to awaken him to his own state of awareness. And if it happens to be that the perfect living master who is giving us a nudge is also ourself at the end of the journey, that makes sense. We made our own arrangement to wake up at the right time. When does a perfect living master appear in our life based on this? It is based upon exactly we fixed the time before we ever came into this universe. At that time we fixed when this will happen. What are the signs in our life that this is the time when we should be meeting such a person? When we are tired of this world. We are fed up. If we are not fed up, it's not our time. If we think we are still to enjoy this world a lot, go on enjoying it. We came for that. You didn't fix the time to go back now, so enjoy. If you have fixed the time, that guy is going to appear in your life. Whether you like it or not, that guy will appear. He will appear by coincidence, by chance, not by your seeking. You are not seeking to find a guy. You are seeking to find the truth. You are seeking to find a higher level of awareness. You are trying to find your own true home where you belong. That's the seeking for. Nothing to do with that guy coming in. You are seeking that, the guy turns up. You can't find him. Because if he was carrying a label or something, I am that guy who come to wake you up, you reject him. That's just an egoistic show. Somebody trying to say, I am the guy to do it. If he says, I am the perfect living master. I have come to do this. I want to go out of the way to come and help you to get up. No, that's just a show. But when the perfect living master comes, he's like an ordinary person. Just like us. No difference. Born like us. Lives like us. Eats, drinks, falls sick like us. Takes medicine like us. Dies like us. No difference. Only one difference, which we can't see. The difference, even as a human being, he is aware, conscious of our true home. He is conscious we are all one. He is conscious how the mind was created. He is conscious how separation of one into many took place. He is conscious of how the world is being made up inside and projected outside. He is conscious of the entire way creation works and the Creator works. How do they know how the Creator works? Because in the oneness there is nobody else except the Creator. We discovered at the end of our journey we were never separate from the Creator. It's a show of the Creator. Entire show. Who is the Creator? We ourselves. At that stage. Not below that. Therefore, such a human being who is carrying that awareness with him at all times 24/7, when he comes into a life, he is ourself in a human form. He is our own soul in the totality of souls. He is our own life in the form of a different life. He is ourself projected as somebody to come at the right time and give us a nudge. And his nudge is given through something that works beyond karma. Something that works beyond action. Something that works beyond thought. Something that works beyond mind. A substance called pure spiritual love. That pure spiritual love haunts us and shakes us because we never experience like that. It's totally unconditional. There's no condition attached at all. It does not require us to behave in a particular way. It does not require us to have a good karma. It does not require us to have a good mind. It does not require anything. It's requiring only one thing. This is the program time which you had fixed yourself. I'm here. That's what that such a person comes into a life. If he says, I am different from you, I've come to give you something, he's not a perfect living master at all. He believes in separation. Perfect living masters know there is no real separation at all. But we, for the sake of experience, we introduced a divider, a separator. We separate ourselves from others, separate ourselves from our own self. Separates ourselves from all the different levels of awareness we can exercise. Separates from everything. And that separator is called our human mind. The human mind is doing all that. And we picked it up nicely to put up the separator. Why do we need to separate? When we were one, we were everything in that oneness. Where was the need for a separator to come and create all the problems which you are trying to solve now? The reason for separation was to create the many out of the one, to experience what the one was. What is the one, if we can describe the one? It can't be described, but let's put it like this. There's something that is happening only through the one in all of us. First is love. Love is not a creation of mind. Love is not a creation of senses. Love is not a creation of this body. Then where is it coming from? It's coming from beyond these three. Therefore, it's a characteristic of the one. Appreciation of beauty. Where does that come from? The one. Full knowledge. Total awareness. Where can it come from? If these three things, the beauty, the knowledge, the love, it's all these things are coming from beyond the mind. And these are the ones that are being experienced by us while we are here. We're getting a nudge. That is why these perfect living masters don't have to say anything. They just pull you. They pull us with their love. And we don't go hunting for them. They hunt us out at the right time. And they have a system by which they are totally aware of how the destinies work. They place themselves in the destiny in which we have to go. But our experience is like we have found something and now we are going to make use of it. I give the example of some blind people. They are all in a room where the walls are all flush and the door cannot be seen with the hands because the same level as the rest of the wall. And they're groping, they're blind, so they're groping around to find a way out. They go on several times in the room but never find the door. Some person who's not blind, somebody who's not blind, enters the room quietly. When he enters, they say, somebody has come. And we know. He knows the door. He came in through the door. Let's find him. Then they keep on groping. Now not only the wall, but other places. Maybe we'll find the guy. They can't see anything. And the guy says, this guy is really a seeker. He's going around looking for the door. And he moves forward and catches his hand. The blind man shouts, I found him. Because he's felt his hand. I found him. Now I know I can get out of the door. He's going to take me out of the door. Takes him out. But the feeling to the blind man is he found it. What was the truth? The awakened man found. The man with eyes found the man who was blind. Same thing happens with us here. A person who is aware of the wakeful state, higher than this state, is the awakened person. For that state, we are blind. We can't see that state. He can. So when he comes into our life and holds our hand, we say, we found somebody. And that love comes, pulls us along, and takes us quietly out of the door for true home. This is the role of perfect living master. Why am I sharing all these things to you when we have been all called for a holiday party? We are supposed to be holidaying. I am giving you a serious lecture. No, I am not giving a serious lecture. I am saying, wake up to have a real holiday. There is a much greater holiday taking place there. In India, we celebrate a function called Diwali. In October, November, it comes every year. We light up all the houses, like we do in Christmas here. Like we do holiday season here. They also do it, but different date. And they celebrate, they distribute food and sweets, and they have dancing and joyful rejoicing. It's a Diwali day, day of lights. This is the day when Lord Rama, after 14 years of sitting in isolation in Banvas, came back to his own town and people celebrated. It's a great day. It's a day connected with some religious activity somewhere. In the midst of that, one mystic, Swami, Seth Sivdyal Singh, who set up Radha Swami, he utters these words, Sant Diwali Nit Kare Sat Lok Ke Mahi. The saints are celebrating the Diwali every night, not on one night, when they withdraw their attention to the true home. Therefore, the real holiday can be observed every day. That's why I'm talking about this stuff with you, that there is another state of being for all of us in which you would have a much greater holiday. If you reach the true home, it'll be holiday all the time. You'll have an eternal holiday. Now we're having eternal ups and downs. Here we are having nothing real, continuous. There's a continuous holiday. So that is why I want to welcome you to this big holiday. We can all achieve by going beyond the unreal holiday that we have created here. But still we can go back. Don't mind spending this holiday here too. Holidays are celebrated in so many ways. They're celebrated by giving gifts to each other. The retail stores here, big stores, in big buildings. I came from India, I'd never seen such big stores. They sell so much stuff in different alleys, different aisles. And I moved among those stores. Hardly any customer. I said, such a huge store. And there's no customer. I went to another store. Big one. I looked at it as a businessman. How much heavy overhead they are having. They're paying for the building. They're paying for so much electricity being burned there. And there's so few customers. How are they in the business? Then I found out that their business is dependent upon the holidays. That in 2 months, they make enough money and profit which lasts for more than a year. That's the holiday spirit, that you can buy these gifts in 2 months, connected with Thanksgiving, Great Friday, Black Friday. Then you have good white and black days at the end of the holiday. And because of that, all the businesses are successful. They are working based upon the holiday. So I said this must be a great time, not only for business people, but also for the people who are enjoying the holiday. So then I said, let me talk to some of these holiday people. And they are coming from their families. One guy says, oh, holidays again. Why are you, people are enjoying, what's happened to you? So many gifts I have to give. Can't afford them, but I have to give. I said, what compels you to get this? All my family will turn away from me if I don't give. I was never aware that holiday can make you so miserable. Some people are enjoying, some are just making a faces of enjoyment. Not a real holiday. And not only that, there are people who study people's minds. They are called psychiatrists. Here they call them shrinks. They shrink your capacity to have holiday. And what happened to them for doing that? Law of karma says they don't deserve to live. And the highest rate of suicides is by psychiatrists in the holidays. Did you know that? The highest level of suicides, first of all, as a class, the highest number of suicides are among psychiatrists. Secondly, in time, the highest level of suicides among psychiatrists are in the holidays. You can imagine, what is the nature of our holiday? Not only that, when we have a holiday, we should feel happy thereafter. But we are not happy. We go into depression. Not everybody. But the people who are most proud of themselves, which means the bachelors, those who are married, not married, they think after hearing my talks that maybe marriage is not a good thing. In the holiday, they are depressed. There is nobody with them. People commit suicide during holidays because they have no one to celebrate with that holiday. Number is very large. If you look at these facts, you imagine what kind of holiday we are celebrating here. Not like this is your true home. This will never happen to home. There's no depression in your true home. There's no depression, no downside of a holiday. Therefore, enjoy your holiday. Enjoy tonight. They used to count the number of days left for Christmas. Count the number of days till 25th of this month and enjoy holiday every night till that day. On 25th, you'll be so beautiful, tranquil. Whether you are a bachelor or not, whether you are single or not, you'll enjoy your Christmas day, I can assure you. But work on it during the night. Work on it by going back to the source of all this. Source of creation. Source of holidays. Source of everything. Inside ourselves. Not very far. Behind the eyes. How could be something be simpler than that? That all you have to do is to put your attention behind the eyes and you will begin to find out that this was not you. You are sitting behind the eyes. How can this be you? That's more conscious than this. You are also going further on into forms which you keep on shedding your outside garments and become like a naked soul and discover you're always happy and always in holiday. You can find out tonight. And you've got many days till 25th to find out. So try and enjoy the holidays till the 25th. And if you don't want to do it, I'll pray for you. They say prayer also works here. Some people pray, may the holidays end. Some people pray, may more holidays come. We are so different in our situations. But I am not against giving presents. Give presents. It's a good thing if it's a symbol. If it's a symbol of your love, symbol of your caring for people, it's good to give a gift. Gifts, there are many gifts you can give. People buy different gifts. Let me use a little mathematics, arithmetic, to tell you about gifts. Supposing you have $100 with you, and you give a gift of $40 to a friend of yours. You are left with 60. The friend has got 40. Total, still 100. Between the two of you. None of you have 100 left anymore. But the totality is still 100, 60, 40. Supposing you have knowledge and you give the gift of knowledge to somebody. Supposing you have 100 units of knowledge you have. You give 40 units of knowledge to somebody. You still have 100. They get 40. It becomes 140. Which means gift of knowledge is really numerically, mathematically better. If you give a gift of love, you have 100 units of love, you give 40 units of love, the love comes back. You get 180, and the other person has got 40. Total 220. Pure arithmetic. Therefore, there is nothing that is a gift of love. So, if you want to express that gift of love and give something with love in your heart, not show of love, not printed love. You can buy printed love too. At, what is it called? Hallmark? Some place you can buy printed love. Very beautifully printed. Beautiful words also. But it should be your own love. Own love that you present with a little card, with a penny, even a penny stuck on it, is worth more than a big gift that you give. In one December, I was in the south, in Texas somewhere, and I said I should give a gift. But the person in whose house I was very rich. They had a child, a son, small son. And they gave so many boxes of that child, of gifts they gave, for his birthday, for good days, for Christmas, for everything. His room, which is child's room, which I went at, the child took me by his hand to show me his room. He had so many gifts. So many were still unpacked. Some had a price tag written on it. They spent a lot of money for the child. And the child didn't even open them. When he would open, he would break them, see what is it, tag, they would break something else. And they would buy more gifts. I told the child, I have a card in my pocket, old expired credit card or something, plastic card. I have a card in my pocket that flies to the sky. He said, I want to see that. I took out that old card and I dropped it and said, there's gone to the sky. He looked up. I want that card. I said, that's very difficult to get the card. He threw all his gifts away looking for the little card which had no value. At the end, he was so happy when I gave him the card. It's the best gift he ever got. A gift of no financial money value at all. How can we think that a child is going to like big boxes of gifts, which he doesn't even open, doesn't understand. And yet he is able to understand if something drives his curiosity and he's willing to run for that curiosity. In a way, we are all children. That's what we want. We want to get something for which we are curious, which we are seeking. It's a perfect living master gives us the gift of love in a way. It's so huge that no gift in the world can match it. It's worth all the wealth of the world put together and so much more. And a perfect living master comes and gives us that kind of a gift for the holidays. Why am I saying this? Because I am going to invoke the gifts from my master, who was a perfect living master, who is a perfect living master for me. You may not see him, but I can see him. From him, I want to give to all of you the gift of love, that you can feel the devotion you the whole year long next year. So that's my gift to you. Thank you very much.